Hello everyone, welcome back. This is an update on General Pediatrics, Chapter 1, Second Edition, 2020. You can follow with me in the Pediatric Board Study Guide, Second Edition, General Pediatrics, Chapter 1, from page 1 to page 34. Growth, page 1 to 4 in the second edition. Assessment of weight starting from birth and in each subsequent well visit is critical. Weight loss more than 10 to 12% in the first week is a red flag. Birth weight usually doubles at 5 to 6 months of age. Birth weight usually triples at 1 year of age. What is the best next step if the infant continue not to gain weight? Not gaining the birth weight in the first 10 to 14 days of life, or weight loss more than 10 to 12% of birth weight in the first week of life? Ask about adequate feeding, nutritional history. Ask about frequency and length of breastfeeding. Infant must feed at least 8 to 12 times a day, every 2 to 3 hours, and length of breastfeeding should be at least 15 minutes on each side. Ensure the proper mixing of formula, frequency, how many feeds per day, and how many mLs the infant is getting. Thorough physical examination, for example, ensuring there is no tongue tie, there is no heart murmur, there is no other abnormalities in the physical exam. If no explanation of abnormal weight loss or failure to thrive, after ruling out reflux and cow's milk protein allergy, investigations must be started to rule out infectious, metabolic, or congenital problems. Height or linear growth. The average length of full-term newborn is about 50 cm. At 1 year of age, birth length increases by 50%. More than 2 years of age, length increases by average 5 cm per year. Approximately. Birth length doubles by 3 to 4 years of age. Growth velocities is the fastest during puberty, is about 6 to 10.5 centimeter per year in girls, is about 7 to 12 centimeter per year in boys. Failure to thrive. If the weight is affected more than the height, the most likely cause is nutritional. Failure to grow. If the height is affected more than the weight, is most likely hormonal. In this growth curve, you will see the percentile of the weight start to be affected between age 5 and 6 years of age, and here the height start to be affected afterward. So the most likely cause here, failure to thrive, nutritional or GI problem. In this growth curve, you will see the decline here, and the height is more affected than the weight. And the most likely cause here, height affected more than the weight, is failure to grow, short stature, or endocrine problem. The average head circumference in a full-term infant is 35 cm. Normal head growth is 1 cm per month in the first 6 months of life, half a cm between 6 months and 12 months of life approximately. Head circumference should be obtained at each well visit from birth to 2 years of age. How to measure the head circumference? Take the most prominent diameter between the occiput and the mid forehead, and the best is to measure it 3 times and take the average. If you encounter an infant with a large head, there are 2 possibilities, macrocephaly or hydrocephalus. Macrocephaly is benign, asymptomatic, normal development. One of the parents is with a large head, and the management here is reassurance. Hydrocephalus is usually symptomatic, failure to thrive, bulging fontanelle, and impaired upward gaze, history of prematurity, history of intraventricular hemorrhage, meningitis, or other congenital causes. Microcephaly means that the head circumference is 2 standard deviations below the mean. Suggested investigations for cases of microcephaly: maternal phenylalanine level, karyotype, head imaging, head ultrasound or head MRI, metabolic screening, Torch virus serum titers, and urine culture for cytomegalovirus. It is important also to investigate for Zika virus if there is any history of travel to high-risk areas. The most common cause of plagiocephaly is positional, that this infant, for example, prefers to keep looking towards this direction. So you will see the head is flat on this side, on the left side, and there is a frontal bulging here on the same side. And if the ears here, if you are able to see the ear, you will see the ear is pushed forward, and the ear on the other side, on the right side, is in normal position. So this is called positional plegiocephaly. This is the most common. The treatment is repositioning by encouraging tummy time while the infant is awake. Place toys at the baby's side. For example, to put the toys in this side, the baby will be looking in the opposite direction, and this will decrease the flattening. Alternate right, left sides for feeding and holding. Repositioning failure by 2 to 3 months of age, the next step is referral to craniofacial specialist. Physical therapy, AEB recommends a cranial remolding orthosis for ages 4 to 12 months of age. This will help to remold the head shape. This is a classic case of craniosynostosis. If you see the head circumference continue to be growing normally until age of 4 months, and between 4 months and 6 months, the head shape start to change and become very elongated, crossing percentile from 50 percentile to 98 percentile. Clinically, this patient is having progressive macrocephaly, very elongated head scaphocephaly, and palpable ridging at the sagittal suture due to premature fusion of sagittal sutures. So this is a classic case of craniosynostosis scaphocephaly due to premature fusion of sagittal sutures. Craniosynostosis is a clinical diagnosis. By having abnormal head shape, palpable ridging of sutures, large head, or macrocephaly. If the diagnosis is suspected, the next step is to refer to pediatric neurosurgeon. No need for a skull radiograph, no need for sure for head CT scan or three-dimensional reconstruction CT scan because of high amount of radiations. Just simply, if you suspect a craniosynostosis, refer to pediatric neurosurgeon. Developmental milestones, page number 4, second edition. Developmental screening tools. AAB recommends Denver Developmental Screening Test, the Ages and Stages Questionnaires or ACQs, modified checklist for autism in toddlers, or well known as MCHAT. In this section, I will focus on normal and abnormal developmental milestones by ages. We'll start with newborn. Newborn will be able to fixate face on light, visual preference for human face, regarding a face shortly after birth, responds to visual threats by blinking, and visually fixes. Newborn developmental red flags, hypotonia, feeding difficulties, does not respond to loud sounds or noises. 2 months of age should be able to chest up in prone position, lift the head and the shoulders of bed in prone position, follows moving objects 180 degrees, recognizes mother, listen to voice and cause, smiles in social contact, reciprocal smiling or interactive smiling. 2 months in developmental red flags, if is unable to hold the head up when pushing up or when on tummy, does not alert to voice, lack of looking at faces, and does not watch things as they move. At 4 months of age, there is no head lag. The infant is able to support the head 100% steady with no head lag, able to lift the head and the chest, able to roll from front to back, when held standing, able to push with feet or able to bear weight on feet, grasp an object and bring to mouth, laugh out loudly, imitates a social interaction, palmar grasp is gone, able to open the hand freely and let go. 4 months developmental red flags. If the infant is unable to hold the head steady, unable to bring things to the mouth, persistent fisting is abnormal, doesn't coo or make sound, doesn't smile at people. Early rolling between 1 and 2 months may indicate spasticity. 6 months is able to sit with support, turns from back to the front, and transfer object from one hand to the other, and stranger and anxiety start at 6 months of age, familiar versus unfamiliar people. 6 months of age stops momentarily toward no, begins to make babbling, imitates sounds, turns directly to sound and voice, smiles and vocalizes to mirror. 6 months developmental red flags if is unable to pass an object from one hand to another, doesn't try to reach an object, floppy like a rag doll, doesn't turn toward sounds, no smiling, no laughing, no expression. 7 months is able to sit without support, this is important, radial palmar grasp, finds partial hidden objects, looks toward familiar object when named, prefers mother. 9 months it begins creeping or crawling, pulls to stand, radial digital grasp of cube, separation and anxiety start at 9 months, orients to name well, says mama, dada, non-specific. 9 months developmental red flags if it's unable to sit without support, not rolling, doesn't babble, no sounds. 12 months should be able to stand well with minimal support, few independent steps, fine pincer grasp, says mama dada specific, speaks an additional word, follow one step command with gesture. 12 months developmental red flags if is unable to stand, unable to bear weight on legs when supported, unable to crawl, doesn't respond to name, doesn't understand no, doesn't look where caregiver points. 15 months of age is able to run stiff-legged, stoops to pick up a toy, drinking from a cup, scribble with a crayon. 15 months also is able to use a spoon with some spilling, turns pages in book, points to one body part, follows single command without gesture, hugs adult in reciprocation, gets object from another room upon demand, uses 3 to 5 words. 15 months developmental red flags, doesn't use words mama, papa, dada, doesn't point to the desired object, unable to do pincer grasps. 18 months runs well, walks upstairs while holding hand, climbs and sits into a chair, throws a ball while standing, makes 4 block tower, able to remove loose garments, matches pairs of objects. 18 months able to pass MCHAT autism screening, and this form is available online. Points to 2 or 3 objects when named and 3 body parts, understands mind, points to familiar people with name, uses 10 to 25 words, imitates sounds, for example, animal sounds. 18 months developmental red flags, unable to walk. So at 18 months is a red flag, unable to walk. Doesn't gain new words. Doesn't have at least 6 words. Doesn't point to show things to other. Does not share interest. 24 months walks downstairs holding rail, both feet on each step, kicks a ball without demonstration, throws a ball overhead, jumps with 2 feet, imitates a circle, imitates a horizontal line, pretend play. 24 months or 2 years able to build a tower of 6 blocks, follows 2 step command, so 1 year 1 step command, 2 years 2 step commands. It starts using I, me, and you pronouns, 2 word sentence, start to build the sentences of 2 words, uses 50 plus word, 50% intelligible speech. 24 months developmental red flags, unable to use 2 word phrases, for example, drink water, unable to follow simple instructions, unable to imitate actions or words, unable to maintain eye contact, unable to walk well. Years of age able to pedal a tricycle, draws man with 2 to 3 parts, copies a circle, knows on gender and age, 3 word sentences, 75% intelligible speech. Years developmental red flags, if unable to use a 3 word sentence, unable to pretend play or make believe, unable to climb stairs well, frequent falling. 4 years of age is able to balance in 1 foot for 8 seconds, able to copy a square, build a gate from blocks, goes to toilet alone, wipes after bowel movement, draws man with 4 to 6 part. Group play, follows 3 step commands, tells stories, speaks clearly in sentences, says 4 to 5 word sentences, understanding 4 prepositions, 100% intelligible speech. 5 years of age able to walk down stairs with rail alternating feet, able to skip, very important, cobbles triangle, cuts with scissors, able to build the stairs with blocks from model. 5 years old able to draw a man with 8 to 10 parts, names a 10 color and counts to 10, dresses and undresses self, apologizes for mistakes, able to say I'm sorry, responds to why questions, knows right and left on self. 5 years developmental red flags if is unable to jump in place, unable to speak clearly, unable to answer simple questions, unable to use pronouns, for example, I, me, you, he, and she correctly, ignores other children. 6 years of age is able to walk heel to toe, which is well known as tandem gait, ride bicycles without training wheels, can draw a diamond shape, able to tie shoes, looks both ways at street, write first and last name, draws a man with 12 to 14 parts. Immunization, second edition, page 16. Vaccination or immunization is casual. At birth, the only vaccine we give hepatitis B vaccine. At 2 months of age, we give combination of vaccines, hepatitis B, DTaP, IPV, which is the killed form of polio virus vaccine, Hib, Haemophilus influenza vaccine, PCV or Prevnar or pneumococcal vaccine, and rotavirus vaccine. We have the option to give combination of hepatitis B, DTaP, and IPV, and is well known as Pediatrics. Pediatrics is combination of three vaccines, hepatitis B, DTaP, and IPV. At 4 months, we give the same except hepatitis B. No need for hepatitis B at 4 months well visit. So we give DTaP, IPV, Hep, PCV, rotavirus vaccine. Also, you have the option to give combination of vaccines, DTaP, hepatitis B, IPV. And in this case, at 4 months, you will give one extra dose of hepatitis B, and this is okay. Hep, PCV, and rotavirus vaccine. At 6 months, we give the same hepatitis B, DTaP, IPV. You have the option to give also Pediatrics in one shot. Also, you don't have to give Hep if you are using PIDVAX, form of Haemophilus influenza vaccine. You need only two doses in the first year. PCV, we have to give it at 6 months. Rotavirus vaccine. If you are using Rotatec, you need three doses. If you are using Rotarix, you need at 2 months and 4 months, and there is no need for Rotarix to be given again at 6 months. Then influenza starts at 6 months of age. 12 months of age, we give Hep the third dose or fourth dose of Hep, depending on the form we used in the first year. PCV, Prevnar or pneumococcal vaccine, varicella, MMR, which is measles, mumps, rubella, and first dose of hepatitis A at 12 months of age. At 15 to 18 months, we need another dose, which is the fourth dose of DTaP. At 18 months, we need the second dose of hepatitis A. It has to be 6 months apart from the first dose. 4 to 6 years, we give DTaP, IPV, MMR, varicella, four shots, or you are able to combine and use combination of Kendrix, which is DTaP and IPV, or combination of MMR, varicella, MMRV, which is measles, mumps, rubella, and varicella in one shot. So you will give two shots. One is intramuscular Kendrix, and one subcutaneous MMR, varicella. Between 11 and 12 years of age, we need to start to give the 11-year shots, which is Tdap, MCV4, which is meningococcal vaccine, and HPV, first dose of HPV. HPV will be given two doses before 15 years of age. High-risk children, which is high risk for infection with invasive bacteria, we are required to give a pneumococcal vaccine, polysaccharide pneumococcal vaccine 23, between age 2 and 18 years of age, but we have to give PCV before. MCV4 can be given as early as 2 years of age to high-risk children, like, for example, complement deficiency. At 11-year well visit, we should have the following vaccine in order to be considered up to date on immunization. 3 doses of hepatitis B, 5 doses of DTaP, 4 doses of IPV or poliovirus vaccine, 2 doses of hepatitis A, 6 months apart, 2 doses of MMR, 2 doses of varicella. And we have to give an additional dose of Tdap at age of 11, meningococcal vaccine MCV4, and human papilloma virus vaccine. An additional dose will be 6 months after the first dose. If you notice here, I did not add Hep, Haemophilus influenza, PCV, or RV, because if they were not given, we don't have to give at this age. If the mother is positive hepatitis B, within 12 hours, we have to give hepatitis B and hepatitis B immunoglobulin. Then we have to give 3 doses after discharge, so the first dose will not be counted. So initial hepatitis B vaccine does not count in this case. And we have to test the baby at 9 months of age. If the hepatitis B status of the mother is unknown at birth, which is more common than hepatitis B positive, test the mother as soon as possible. Give routine hepatitis B vaccine after birth within 12 hours. Then if the test turned to be positive, give hepatitis B immunoglobulin as soon as possible. If you have a 4-month-old, never vaccinated before, or is coming for catch-up vaccine and never received a rotavirus vaccine, there is no need to give or to start the series of rotavirus vaccine at age of 4 months. Same scenario, if you have 8 months old and did not complete the series of rotavirus vaccine, also you do not have to give an additional dose of rotavirus vaccine. If there is a family history of intersusception, it is recommended to give the rotavirus vaccine, not personal history. Very important to pay attention in the question. If it's family history of intersusception, it is okay to give rotavirus vaccine, not personal history. It is important to know that DTaP should be given only to children less than 7 years of age, and TDAP only to children 7 years and older. What happens if you give DTaP to a child older than 7? By mistake, this dose should be considered. Two vaccines we don't have to give at age of 5 or older: Haemophilus influenza vaccine, pneumococcal vaccine. So if you have a child coming for catch-up at age of 6 or 7 or older than 5, you do not need to give Haemophilus influenza or Prevnar or pneumococcal vaccine to healthy children older than 5. If we have a child is immune compromised or having a disease associated with immune deficiency, we are able to give Hep or Haemophilus influenza vaccine, PCV or pneumococcal vaccine, even if the child is older than 5 years of age. Another case scenario, if we have immune compromised or immune suppressed child and 2 years and older, we are able to give the polysaccharide pneumococcal vaccine 23, but we have to give a dose first of PCV 13, and 8 weeks later we have to give the a dose of PPSV 23. See table 1.6 page 18 for more details in the second edition. Influenza vaccine is highly recommended for children 6 months and older. For children between age 6 months and 8 years, if they never received influenza vaccine, they should receive initially 2 doses 4 weeks apart, if it's first time. Can we give the influenza vaccine to a child with history of egg allergies or history of anaphylaxis to eggs? The answer is yes. Always yes to give influenza vaccine to children with egg allergies, even if they had severe allergic reaction. But if there is a history of severe allergic reaction or anaphylaxis to eggs, we have to give the influenza vaccine under supervision of a healthcare provider who's able to manage severe allergic reactions. Measles or MMR vaccine is highly recommended to children who are traveling to high risk areas of measles disease. If the infant is between 6 months and 11 months, we have to give 1 dose before departure, and this dose doesn't count towards the vaccination of MMR vaccine. 12 months and older, we have to give 2 doses before departure, 4 weeks apart. If we have an actual measles exposure, and the exposure is less than 72 hours, and the infant is older than 6 months, we can give a dose of MMR as soon as possible to infants 6 months and older. If the exposure more than 72 hours, less than 6 days, and the infant is less than 12 months, we can give MMR immunoglobulin. For more details, see table 1.8, page 21 in the second edition. MMR vaccine is contraindicated to be given to a pregnant woman, but if it was given because she didn't know or any other reason, there is no indication to do an abortion. If a child is allergic to eggs, it is okay to give MMR vaccine. MMR vaccine and tuberculosis. We have 3 clinical case scenarios. If you have a child is going to be tested for tuberculosis with PPD test, and also is scheduled to give MMR vaccine in the same day, it is okay to do that. You do TB test, skin test, PPD, and MMR at the same time, in the same day. If the MMR vaccine was given a day before or week before, we have to wait 4 weeks to do the PPD test. If the child is positive for tuberculosis, you are able to give the MMR vaccine, but after the TB treatment has started. Exposure to varicella. Give the vaccine if the child is healthy, 12 months or older, within 3 to 5 days after varicella or herpes zoster exposure if the child is not up to date on vaccines with varicella. Give varizig or immunoglobulin of varicella to high risk infants within 10 days to the newborn infant whose mother had chickenpox, not zoster, or within 5 days before delivery, or within 48 hours after delivery, also can be given to immune-compromised children. Hepatitis A vaccine. The catch-up on the vaccine, the minimum interval between the two doses is 6 months apart. We have to wait 6 months between the first and second dose. If you have a child traveling to endemic area, high-risk area of hepatitis A, if it's less than 12 months, give hepatitis A immunoglobulin. We cannot give hepatitis A vaccine to children less than 12 months. If it's more than 12 months, just start the hepatitis A vaccine before departure. So you give hepatitis A 4 weeks before departure. Routine immunization usually will start at 12 months and we give two doses 6 months apart. Hepatitis A exposure, the same as if traveling to endemic area. If the infant is less than 12 months, we give hepatitis A immunoglobulin. If it's older than 12 months, we have to catch up on vaccine. We have to give hepatitis A within 2 weeks of exposure. And you will do the second dose afterward, 6 months after. Immune compromised or chronic liver disease, give hepatitis A immunoglobulin after exposure. Meningococcal vaccines now are indicated to all children 11 through 12 years of age routinely. Give a single dose of Menectra or Menvio vaccine at age 11 through 12 years of age, and this covers strain A, C, W, and Y. It doesn't cover for meningococcal B. Then you need to give a booster dose at age of 16 years. Also, it is indicated to freshmen college who previously unvaccinated. Meningococcal vaccine B now is recommended between age 10 and 25 years of age. We have two types, Tromemba, which is 3-dose series, and we have Bexsero 2-dose series. Meningococcal vaccines can be given to children as young as 2 years and older if they are at high risk. For example, children with anatomic or functional aspelinia, including sickle cell disease, children with persistent complement component deficiency, children with HIV. Meningococcal exposure or exposure to meningococcus bacteria. It has to be close contact. Very important to pay attention to this word, close contact. For example, household living in the same house, daycare or preschool, intubation and exposure to secretions of the patient. Initiate prophylaxis within 24 hours. The medications are rifampin or cipro or ceftriaxone if pregnant. Human papillomavirus vaccines prevent cervical cancer. It is a killed virus, is not a live virus. Prevent genital warts due to type 6, 11, 16, and 18. We need to administer a 2-dose series of HPV vaccine in children less than 15 years of age. 3-dose series in children 15 years and older. Administrations of vaccines. We have only one oral vaccine. Rotavirus vaccine. It comes in two forms, Rotatec or Rotarex. Rotatec 3-dose series and Rotarex is 2-dose series in the first year of life. Oral polio vaccine no longer in US, but it is considered if you have a child coming from another country with immunization record showing oral polio vaccine, consider these vaccines towards immunization status. Subcutaneous vaccines, we have MMR and varicella. What happens if you give MMR or varicella intramuscular by mistake? It is considered to be count, so you are able to count that toward the immunization status. You don't have to repeat. Intramuscular, all other vaccines are intramuscular. Contraindications to vaccines. It is important to know that it is always okay to give the vaccine. For example, the child is having fever, 102, 103 Fahrenheit, otitis media, diarrhea, taking antibiotic, give the vaccine. It is okay to give the vaccine. Always this is the correct answer. The exceptions are few, and pay attention to that. Severe allergic reaction to this specific vaccine. So if you have a child with history of severe allergic reaction to influenza vaccine, anaphylaxis, do not give influenza vaccine. It is contraindicated. If you have a child, for example, with history of encephalopathy after giving DTaP, do not give DTaP. If the child is immune deficient, do not give live vaccines, but you are able to give the rest of the vaccines. No live vaccine, no rotavirus, no MMR, no varicella. Preventive Medicine, second edition, page 23. It is important to be familiar with newborn screening. It is critical to know how to follow the results of newborn screening and the instructions of the state. For all newborn screening results in your practice. All states screen for congenital hypothyroidism, phenylketonuria. Other states added more diseases, for example, metabolic and hemoglobin diseases. First newborn screening before discharge within 24 to 48 hours after birth. Second newborn after discharge from newborn nursery. Newborn screening will be done between 1 and 2 weeks of age. It is highly recommended now to screen all newborn for hyperbilirubinemia. Newborn bilirubin screening. Measure total serum bilirubin or transcutaneous bilirubin with J meter before discharging any newborn from the newborn nursery. Do risk factor assessment. This will help you to determine when this newborn need to be followed after discharge. It is highly recommended to measure the blood pressure now routinely to all children starting at age of 3 years and then in each well visit on yearly basis after. Blood pressure measurements at visits before 3 years of age if coexisting medical conditions associated with hypertension. If you have a child in the well visit and is asymptomatic, presenting with hypertension, the best next step is to repeat the blood pressure to make sure it is correct and measure it yourself. If the child is crying or having fever or illness or hospitalized, do not consider this as hypertension. Just repeat in another visit when the child is healthy. We have to choose the appropriate pediatric cuff size in order to obtain a correct blood pressure measurement in any child. And the size of the bladder is according to or will be in relation to the mid-arm circumference, which is midway between the acromion and olecranon. The bladder or the cuff bladder is located in this area where the air goes in and the pressure applied. The length of the bladder is starting from here to here, and this length should encircle at least 80 to 100%, but not more than 100% of mid-arm circumference. And the width from here to here should be at least 40% of the mid-arm circumference. Visual assessment starts from newborn nursery and in each well visit into adolescence. Be familiar to examine the eye. Inspect the eye in each newborn and in each well visit for strabismus. Early detection of strabismus or misalignment of the eye allows early treatment of amblyopia and saving binocular vision. Inspect or examine the eye for red reflex. You should have red reflex in both eyes. This will allow early detection of cataracts and retinoblastoma. Refer to a pediatric ophthalmologist to all cases of strabismus as soon as possible. Wide pupil reflex should be referred urgently for early detection of cataracts or retinoblastoma. Cases of refraction disorders also should be referred. Refer 3 to 5 years of age if they have vision 20 over 40 or worse with one or both eyes. More than 5 years of age if the vision 20 over 30 with one or both eyes or worse. Two line difference between both eyes, retinopathy of prematurity, a significant eye pain, redness in the eye not responding to the treatment in the office, or any case in the eye not responding to the treatment in the primary care office should be referred to a pediatric ophthalmologist. Hearing screening. AAP recommended screening all infants by age of 3 months. Classically, we screen all newborn before discharge from newborn nursery. Formal hearing screening afterward is recommended at age 4, 5, 6, 8, 10 years, and once between 11 and 14 years, 15 to 17 years, 18 and 21 years of age. Hearing screening in special situations. For example, if parents express concern of hearing a problem, language, speech or developmental delay, any child with speech delay should be referred for a formal hearing or audiology testing. History of bacterial meningitis, neonatal cytomegalovirus infection, head trauma, syndrome associated with hearing loss, for example, Alport syndrome, exposure to ototoxic medication, for example, aminoglycosides. Developmental screening should be done in each well visit or any time the parents are concerned, but specifically should be done at age 9, 18, and 30 months of age using a screening tool, for example, ASQ. Autism screening is recommended at 18 months and 24 months of age. Method of screening using MChat questionnaires. Red flags of autism: speech delay or no speech, lack of social interactions, lack of showing, bringing, or pointing out objects of interest. Lead screening is recommended for all children at age 1 and 2 years of age if they are under Medicaid or living in high-risk environment. Elevated capillary blood level should be confirmed with a venous sample. If the level is 5 micrograms or more, public health action should be initiated. There is no safe blood lead level in children. Iron deficiency screening is recommended at 1 year of age. Screening of high-risk children is recommended, children with prematurity, early introduction of cow's milk, strict vegans, poverty, associated medical conditions. HIV screening is now recommended for all adolescents once between age 15 and 18 years of age. Younger than that, if the adolescent at high risk or increased risk, should also be screened. High risk, for example, male-to-male sexual contact, injection drug use, heterosexual contact. Depression screening. Universal screening for depression annually is recommended between age 12 and 21 years of age. Screening younger children at age of 10 or more is recommended if they are at high risk. Routine testing for tuberculosis is no longer recommended, but now American Academy of Pediatrics and the Bright Futures guidelines suggest tuberculosis risk assessment, not testing, risk assessment by 1 month of age at 6, 12, 24 months and annually thereafter. If there is any risk, go ahead for testing. Screening for dyslipidemia is recommended now to all children once between 9 and 11 years of age and once between 17 and 21 years of age. Younger than that, between age 2 and 8 years of age, if one parent has a total cholesterol of 240 mg per deciliter or higher, and the testing will be non-fasting cholesterol, non-fasting, non-HDL cholesterol. Oral health screening. Refer to a dentist with first tooth eruption or at 12 months to establish a dental home. Once a tooth erupts, it should be brushed twice daily with plain water. 2 years and older, brush teeth twice daily with a pea-sized amount of fluoride toothpaste. Daily flossing is recommended. No sharing utensils, no cleaning pacifier by mouth. Second edition, page 29. Car seats should always be in the back seat, never in the front. Rear-facing car seat is recommended until age 2 to 4 years, as long as possible. Forward-facing car seat, after outgrowing rear-facing car seat until at least 5 years of age. Booster seat, after outgrowing the forward-facing car seat until seat belt fits properly. The recommended height to be able to wear the seat belt without car seat for proper seat belt fit is 57 inches, which is 4 feet and 9 inches tall, and 9 to 12 years of age. Drowning prevention. Recommend to all families they have a swimming pool at home to have a fence. Enclose pools completely with 4-sided, at least 4 feet fence and self-closing gate. Life jackets are recommended in boats and when playing near water. Do not leave children unattended in baths. They can drown in seconds. Supervise closely. Adults should be within 1 arm reach of a child in or near water. Teach children to know how to swim. Very important. Install a smoke detector on every level of the home and near sleeping areas to prevent fire and burns. Adjust temperature. Reduce the water heater temperature to 120 degrees Fahrenheit to prevent accidental burning with hot water. Do not drink hot liquids near children. Never leave the stove unattended. A child abuse should be suspected if we have sharp demarcated burn. If it is important to have a gun at home, it is important to know the gun safety. It is important to keep the unloaded gun away from the magazine in 2 separate locked cabinets. Poisoning prevention. Keep all potential poisons in original containers to prevent accidental drinking and out of reach. Keep all medications out of reach of children. Place a child-resistant caps on medications. Install carbon monoxide detectors in every level of home. Keep poison control number near the phone. Choking prevention: remove comforters, pillows, and stuffed animals from crib. Avoid nuts. It is a common cause of foreign body aspiration and choking. Avoid giving carrots, popcorn, and hot dog pieces to young children. Keep coins, batteries, and small objects away from children less than 5 years of age. For example, if you are giving grape, you can cut it small pieces instead of giving the whole grape to a young child. Baby walkers are highly discouraged. No baby walkers with wheels. Baby walkers increase risk of falls and skull fracture. Actually, they do not make babies walk earlier. Children love the bicycle, so it is important to be familiar with bicycle safety. Helmet is critically important, should fit properly and be worn in the proper position, should be replaced every 5 years or earlier. It is important to learn all essential aspects of bicycle safety, for example, reflectors and brake. Keep children less than 10 years of age off the road. Passengers on a bicycle should be at least 1 year or older. Sun exposure can cause sunburn and malignant melanoma, even in children. Protective clothing such as long sleeves, wide brim hats should be worn while outdoors. Avoid sun exposure when the sun is intense the most between 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. when possible. Applying sunscreen and wearing sunglasses are highly recommended. Infants younger than 6 months should be kept out of direct sunlight and protected with clothing and hats. Sunscreen recommendations: broad spectrum sunscreens with a sun protective factor SPF of at least 30 or higher on both cloudy and sunny days. Sunscreens should be applied 15 to 30 minutes before sun exposure to allow formation of a protective film on the skin. Reapply sunscreen every 2 hours and after swimming or sweating. Tanning is not recommended. Why? Because artificial ultraviolet rays may cause sunburn, skin dryness, pruritus, or photokeratitis. Long-term exposure may cause cataracts, skin aging, and cancer. Mosquito repellents, for example, DEET, should be applied on the skin before outdoor activities to prevent mosquito bites. Repellents with 10 to 30% DEET should be safe and effective. And this is recommended for children 2 months and older. Younger children, younger than 2 months of age, should not use products with DEET. The most common complications of mosquito bites is urticaria reaction, large leukocyte reaction, malaria in high-risk areas, West Nile virus infections in high-risk areas. Treatment of large leukocyte reaction after mosquito or insect bite: give oral antihistamine, apply ice in a wet washcloth for 20 minutes, apply topical hydrocortisone cream, give systemic steroid in severe cases. The second edition of the Pediatric Board Study Guide is available on Springer, Amazon websites, and other online stores. This is the end of this presentation. Thank you for listening. This video is only for educational purpose and not intended to direct the care of any specific patient. Please consult your physician or the physician of your child for the correct diagnosis and the proper treatment. None of my videos can be superior or an alternative for the opinion of an experienced and licensed healthcare professional. Thank you again.